I'm going to talk to you today about visualizing yummy data, and I'm going to tell you what that means. We had to put food names to our presentation, so that's where the yummy came from. So, but this is really yummy. This is like an amazing unicorn cake. Am I blocking the cake? And okay, does someone here has a child who's like 5-year-old or 6? Okay, is she really passionate about unicorns?
Yeah.
So imagine you're throwing a birthday party and you want to make this cake for her. And you think, I mean, a unicorn cake, how hard can it be? And so you get the best ingredients that you have. This is like imported cocoa and free-ranged eggs and organic food coloring. And you come home early. You even bought this thingy that makes the curls for the unicorn. And you came home early from work and you're working on it in the kitchen and you're really thinking about how happy she's going to be. And when the party starts, you finish working on your cake and you put it out. So you take it out and the child, she's not impressed. I mean, she might even cry, and the other parents, they're kind of judging you because why did you take this on? And you know it's a really good cake. I mean, everything is made really, really well, and you even use the piping bag, and it's technically a unicorn, but the presentation of it is so bad that I don't know if the kids even want to eat it. So this is your data. And we have really good data. We have a lot of data here in Monday. And this is our tools. And we have amazing professional tools that we can use. And still, sometimes this is our visualizations. And that's kind of a shame because they can be really, 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 really much more appetizing. And I want to talk to you today on how you can do that. So my name is Ronnie. I'm a product designer at the P&I team. Yeah. And a data visualization teacher. And I'm also a really, really, I'm really, really into data viz. And because of that, I made a few projects documenting in data visualization my personal life. And I'm gonna show it later. But first, just say like, what is data visualization? So basically everything that presents data in a visual way. And the purpose is to make us understand information easier rather than reading it in a page and the complex textual database. We can use visualization to help us easily scan it and quickly find insights in the data. Avo. So in a perfect world, we're going to have the exact amount of data that our audience has the attention to get. But we know it's probably not that way because we have an exponential amount of data going on in the world, and we really need to perceive a lot of data in 1 second, but our attention span keeps on becoming lower and lower and we have less time to consume it. Avo. Only in big brain, we have, and this is going to be hard with the numbers, okay? Bear with me. So 8,000 events logged in Big Brain each second. That's 500,000 each minute. And 30 million each hour. And 690 million every day. So, and that's only Big Brain because we have tickets and Zendesk tickets and financial reports and A/B testings and tons of more information. And really, visualization is our best friend. So we can be able to tell our story through data in a manner that's easy to understand. And then, I mean, we go out and do those types of visualization, which I know none of you do. And I know it kind of makes me want to cry or even, I don't know, laugh, but we don't do these types of visualization, but we can do these types of visualization, and we really think it's cute. You know, taking a lot of logos and putting them together and icons because it's all like very smiley and happy, but really in the end, it kind of looks like a tapestry. It's like a carpet, and we don't really understand anything. There's no focus. These types of visualizations, we see every day. They're made with some good tools that we have access to, and they're much cleaner, but still they're very, very complicated to understand, especially for someone who's not really familiar with the data or is not that professional in reading information. So my vision for you all is that nobody in monday.com will have to feel confused trying to piece together a complicated data visualization, especially when you're waiting on your food at lunchtime and you've got a text that it's already arrived. Yeah. So, yeah, true that. So I'm gonna take you on a little test. So you have 3 seconds. I'm gonna show you a slide. Design team, don't tell the secret. And you're gonna tell me how many blue parasols, shimshia, you see in the photo. Okay, you're ready? עכשיו את עוצרת כשהטיימר הופך לאפס. Go. עכשיו. How many?
Six.
Okay, again. And now? 12. Okay, so what we did is we took the information, we kind of arranged it a little bit, and we grouped together what is related, and we put it in an order, and it's so much easier to understand. And this is, I want to go in depth into this one and like tell you what's the superpower of data visualization. So the first one, we have 3 of them, and the first one is that it's easy to digest. So if you want to present a full report, and you can hope that people are going to read it through, all the way through, and even get what you're trying to say, but visualizing it makes it so much easier to digest. This diagram shows a ton of information. This is measles, the disease, measles cases in the US in the last 100 years, and it's a ton of information. It's very, very complex, and also it's very easy to digest. And you can clearly see that there is a problem in the beginning of the first beginning of the graph, and then the 60s something happened, and what happens is that the vaccine was introduced. So this is very, very compelling, which brings me to the other superpower that data visualization has, is that because it's using image, it makes it easier for us to understand and read it. Like, our mind can read images 60 times faster than it can read words or numbers. So when we present data in an image, we make sure that people remember it more and to more detail. So this data set is like I went from measles to doctors, and this data set is about the doctors and doctors per inhabitant in the world. And without even knowing what we're talking about, you know that there's a problem in Africa, and why? It's red, it's big, it's in the middle. Those are things that we don't even think about. And if this was written in an Excel sheet, if you've gotten it in an Excel sheet, it would be much harder to get any insight out of it. Talking about insights and pattern, visualization makes pattern emerge very quickly, and we can detect trends, and we can pinpoint how two or more things are related, which we couldn't have if it wasn't visualized. And for this, I'm going to talk to you about Joe Snow. Not this one, but the statistician and physician from the 19th century. He wanted to prove that, again, diseases, cholera, is made from drinking polluted water and not from the air, which people thought. So he did this. He combined the sets of who's ill with the disease, with all the little lines here, and the geography of this neighborhood in London, and also water pumps in the area. And what was clearly evident is that there was one pump who was contaminated, and most of the cases were surrounded around this pump. So if we look at it in like modern day heat map, we can clearly see where is the problem. And this is something that we would not be able to get without presenting it in a visual way. Okay, so I'm gonna give you 4 data visualization tips that will not cure cholera, but maybe you can make some nice visualizations with. So. The first one is know your audience. I mean, when you're coming to present something to someone, you really have to ask yourself, how much do they already know? Are they very familiar with the data? Do they have time to listen to it? Are they very data-oriented? Like, think about it like a game of catch. If you want someone to catch the ball, you have to throw it really, really well. And the better you throw the ball, the better it's easy to catch. And if you throw a lot of balls in the air all the time, so you're kind of overwhelming them with data, and they won't be able to catch it. So In order to understand what we want to say, we also have to think about what we're not going to say and what we're going to leave out. It might be good for someone to talk about the chart and go in depth and all the numbers, but sometimes it's easier to just have a before and after graph and get the point across in a minute. So I want you to think about this like scheme that I made to think about what visualizations you want to use. Because if you have someone who's very professional and he can really, really read data well, and also is very, very committed, he has attention to read it, so you can sit together with a data set and work together and think about the numbers and see the trends emerging. But if that's not the case and someone is less data literate, which is a term that is used, and also they have less of an attention, they might need something quicker, like a chart or even a number. The other thing is that we need a human-friendly chart type. So, you know, you see a lot of visualizations, which is like, what are you talking about, those spiders visualizations? That you kind of don't know what we're talking about, and I want to have a game with you. So, which one of these is the bigger chunk of the pie chart? Okay, just do it with a show of hands. The yellow one? No. Blue? Red? It's popular. Green? This? Or are they all the same?
The same.
Okay. Next.
The same.
Okay. So this is the exact same data set. And even if you did get the green one right, Dana, so did you get the second largest or the third largest? So why is this happening? Is because the human brain is so much more proficient in determining the differences with length and position. This was proven by a set of experiments by two scientists called Cleveland and McGill, where they gave people tasks to perform with different visualizations, and they saw that we can tell minor differences in position and also in length, but we really are not so good in determining differences in area and volume. So bar chart is a really good friend. And also there's another experiment that shows that people kind of have the story in mind where they look in a visualization. So they ask people, what do you see here? And they said, well, A is less than B. And the same data set, what do you look here? And here it's like A becoming B or A transforming into B. And even when they gave them something that really didn't make that much sense, they invented a story to fit this perception of what they had. So here there's less women than there's men. And here it's the women that have transformed into becoming male, or that the taller you are, the more masculine you are. These are answers that people gave. So bear that in mind, that if you want to talk about comparison, it's better to use this. Or if you want to talk about a process, this is better. Okay, the third rule. Two more to go. Okay, the third rule is be a ruthless minimalist. And for this one, I want to introduce you to a term called data ink ratio. And basically what it means, this is a term coined by the statistician Tufte, which is also data visualization guru. And he said data ink is the ink that we use to convey the data within our visualization. And non-data ink is all the rest. So we're not likely to use any ink today, but the principle stays the same, and I wanna show you what we're going to do here, and I'm gonna do it with a personal story. Bear in mind, it's too personal, maybe. So yeah. So remember I told you that sometimes I do visualizations about my experience in life? So like 10 years ago, I was single, and I was desperate for love, and I decided that I'm gonna have this dating experiment, and I'm gonna go out with to one date every week for a year. And I marked like what I felt and what happened. So I'm gonna show you the graph that I did about like those relationships that I had, and we're gonna simplify together. Okay, so yeah, you see there's a few of them, and one is like really flat and one is very volatile and passionate, but this is the graph, and there is a lot of like data ink ratio crimes going on here. So first of all, this is going to be fast. I took away the background because we don't really need it. It has no purpose. All the numbers, do we really need to know the exact day of each month and its full name? No, so we can like space it a little bit and use abbreviations. And now the title kind of looks clumsy because in percentage of the relationship versus, let's try to make it simpler. And I've put like the intensity here with the percentage mark, so we don't have to have it here. Saved us some ink. And then I took away the grid marks because we're not really into like what exactly happened when, we want to look at the trend. And another thing is that let's take away also the legend, which I usually don't recommend, but in this sense, because of the chart is so airy and light right now, we can use them as labels. And if we want to further illustrate like the connection between the labels and the trends, we can use color. So at the end, we have this clear chart. And if we really want to emphasize the takeaway of this chart, we can gray it all out and see the one up and to the right, which is my today husband. So I've just told you a story. And this is what I'm asking you to do. Tell a story, OK? Because when you want people to relate to what you're saying, you really, really need to make them care about it. I mean, what do you care about my dating experience? But when it becomes a story, that's the best way to make someone care about something. So telling a story is really, really simple, okay? Only the thing that you need is a setup. It's like the beginning. What happened? Where are we at? Once upon a time in a land far, far away. This kind of thing. And then a conflict, like what happened? What are we trying to do? What is the quest? What's changed? Something dramatic. And then the resolution, which is what we're gonna do, how we fixed it, how everything came to be. Okay, so we can do that really, really easy, even with just numbers. Okay, so we have this number. I don't know, it doesn't mean a lot. So we wanna have the setup, okay? What does it mean? Where do we start? So is it good or is it bad? What's the conflict? Has it gone down or has it gone up or has it gone down and up again? Yeah? And then the resolution. Okay, so we saw it's going up, it's going down. We set up a target. That's what we're going to do. Okay, everything is under control. So this is really easy if you think about it. And you can use things that people are adjusted to see, like colors. Okay, so we really, really work well with those colors. I really, really tried to break that when I was the beginning of my career, but really people really see red as bad and negative. Harness that to your message. And the last thing, maybe the last like lesson that I have to give to you, advice, Taveri, is that the data is never just this one truth. I mean, you can always decide how do you want to display it. And this is a page from a Chinese newspaper in 2011 saying, showing how many people died in Iraq. And you can see like they turned the graph around and the blood is dripping and it's like horror and it's bloody and it's terrible. And then the title also kind of gives the insight already. It's Iraq bloody toll. But if we're gonna like have a little experiment and we're gonna turn it around and we're gonna put it in a neutral color and then even change the headline, death is in the decline, we get the exact same data and even almost the exact same design. But the story is so much, is different. So you have the power to tell the story. You can use it the way you want it to use it. To conclude, I've told you four stories which will help you remember what we've just said. The first one, know your audience. Remember the ball? Only throw the ball that you know that they can catch. The other one, be friendly with the chart that you choose. and don't make them think about women becoming men or all that. Be a minimalist, regardless of my love life. You know, take away anything that it's not related to the data, and tell a compelling story, something that your audience wants to hear and can relate to. Thank you.